All right, we'll have our next talk now. Our next speaker is Dr. Patrick Ryan, who's the Vice President of Observational Health Data Analytics at Janssen Research and Development. He's been leading efforts there to develop and apply analytic methods to better understand real-world effects of medical products. He's also the original collaborator of Odyssey, Observational Health Data Sciences and Informatics, a multi-stakeholder interdisciplinary collaborative to create open source solutions that bring value of observational health data through large-scale analytics. He's basically served as the PI of OMOP. If you've been working in healthcare data, you know what OMOP is, and he was the PI, which is essentially a partnership chaired by FDA to lead methodological research to assess appropriate use of observational health data for drug safety issues. So Patrick Ryan has had a family emergency, and so he won't be able to join us in person, but we'll be playing his talk. And during the Q&A, George Ripsack, who is a professor at DPMI at Columbia and also leads Odyssey Coordinating Center, will join the Q&A section. So welcome Patrick Ryan and George.
Hi, I'm Patrick Ryan. I'm a Vice President of Observational Health Data Analytics at Johnson & Johnson, an adjunct assistant professor in the Department of Biomedical Informatics at Columbia University, Irving Medical Center. And today I'd like to discuss observational health data sciences and informatics, an open science journey towards machine learning for healthcare. I really want to apologize that I'm not able to be at MLHC in person today. Unfortunately, I had a death in the family that required me to join my family. But I really wish you all a great conference. Thank the organizers for the flexibility to allow me to present in this recorded format. What I'd like to focus on is the shared journey that we all have and the challenge of using healthcare data and translating information that's captured for a given patient at the routine course of clinical care and how that information can translate into reliable evidence. And we all struggle along this journey for a wide number of well-recognized reasons. I'm going to focus today's conversation on opportunities that I see we have as a community for trying to improve this journey. One of the challenges, of course, we have if we're trying to go from data to evidence is to think about the challenges inherent to the data itself. There are lots of different types of observational health data. Data can vary in terms of populations and care setting, data capture process and health systems. When we talk about observational health data, we're talking about information captured during the routine course of clinical care. But that can be for the clinical care itself that may be captured in electronic health record systems, or for the administration of healthcare that may be captured through insurance systems and administrative claims. And where the care is provided matters, and how the care is provided, and what policies are governing that care provided. And all of that has a direct influence on what data is captured, how that data is captured, and whether or not it potentially can be fit for purpose for generating evidence. Now, another aspect of the challenge in turning to evidence is what type of evidence we're actually trying to generate. There's a wide array of different opportunities for using healthcare data to generate important insights that can be directly useful for decision making. I'll classify these into three categories. Clinical characterization, this is descriptive epidemiology, whereby we can use the information to understand what's happened to a population. This can be used for studying disease natural history, treatment utilization, and quality improvement. We can conduct patient level prediction. Applying machine learning algorithms to be able to identify the probability of a given individual experiencing some outcome. And that can be used for precision medicine and disease interception. And we can also conduct population level effect estimation, causal inference for purposes of understanding medical interventions, for purposes of safety surveillance and comparative effectiveness. Now, each of these different types of data have their own phenomenon that we need to understand, and each of these different types of evidence needs its own analytical processes, own evaluation framework to make sure that evidence is indeed reliable. Within the Odyssey community, we've been thinking a lot about the question of what does it mean to be reliable evidence generated from data? And we've developed a framework to think about the desired attributes of what really constitutes reliable evidence. I would assert that, as with all good scientific processes, at a minimum, evidence generated should be generated in such a way that it is truly repeatable. That is, same researcher asking the same question against the same data and applying the same analysis better be able to prove that they can generate the same exact result. Moreover, I would assert that results should be reproducible. That is, a different researcher who had access to the same data and applied the same methods for the same question should also be able to generate results. Now, I would assert as a field generating evidence from real-world data that these very basic tenets that we all learned in middle school science class are often violated when it comes to observational health data analytics. I can attest that even some of the papers that I've published previously in my career, I'm not sure that I could go back and repeat them, and I'm pretty confident that I have not provided sufficient transparency so that other researchers could prove their reproducibility. But beyond repeatability and reproducibility, we'd really like for our evidence to be replicable. That is, that we're not just looking for somebody to be able to conduct the exact same experiment as us, but we'd like to see that a same or different researcher could apply the same analyses to similar data for the identical question and get similar types of results. And indeed, if we can replicate a finding across a different data set, we would indeed feel much more confident about that phenomenon. But we have an opportunity in healthcare to go even further than that. I would assert that reliable evidence should also be generalizable. That is, that we're not just seeking to be able to answer a question in a similar data set, but if we were able to apply our question to different types of data and yield similar results, we'd feel good. That is specifically to say, if we could conduct an analysis on a data set that's administrative claims and also on a data set that's in electronic health records, and yet observe the same fundamental phenomenon, we would feel more confident about that, given that the results have generalized to a different data source. Or if we could conduct an analysis in the US and see that it also holds up in a data set in the Netherlands and a data set in South Korea, then we could also think that our phenomenon may be generalizable across geographic populations. I'd also assert that we believe that reliable evidence should be robust. That is, that when we have the opportunity to do retrospective analysis of observational data, whether it be the same or different set, there's a multitude of different analysis choices that one could make. And yet, if we're talking about true findings about some clinical phenomenon, we should be able to observe similar findings even when we apply alternative analysis approaches, so long as those analyses are appropriate for the question at hand. Now, last but also very importantly, I would assert that reliable evidence needs to be something that can be generated from statistically calibrated methods, and we need to be able to prove that our methods are in fact generating calibrated results. That is to say, if we apply a statistical method against some sort of control experiment using the same data, the same analysis, we should be able to prove that our results are statistically consistent. Now, these attributes of reliable evidence, repeatability, reducibility, replicability, generalizability, robustness, and calibration, these are attributes that I would assert that most observational studies fall far short of. And it's no wonder why evidence that is generated from observational data quite often is seen with tremendous scrutiny and skepticism if we can't actually prove that the evidence we generate is reliable. We've been thinking a lot in the Odyssey community about how to make evidence reliable and how to prove that the evidence is indeed trustworthy. And I'd like to just share some of the insights from our community as it relates to the proper application of machine learning against healthcare data. Now, I highlighted that there are three primary evidence use cases that we focus on in our Odyssey community. There's clinical characterization, descriptive analysis, just to detail what happened to them. There's patient-level prediction, so being able to answer that non-causal inference question about what will happen to me, given what I've observed in my past medical history. And then there's population-level effect estimation. What are the causal effects of medical interventions? And what we've recognized is that each of these different analysis use cases requires different statistical methods, requires different evaluation frameworks, requires different contexts for how we disseminate and make use of that evidence. And yet what they all have in common is that for us to be able to generate reliable evidence, we need to be able to standardize the data that's going to be able to use. We need to be able to standardize the analytic tools that we're using. And we need to be able to speak a common language by standardizing the vocabulary across a data network so that we can work across these questions to generate evidence that we believe has the integrity to be used for clinical insights. Now, last is taxonomy of data science tasks. And I just want to align what I'm going to be describing here throughout this presentation with what Miguel presented. Now, Miguel highlighted his taxonomy to describe that there's three tasks that he outlines in ascending order of description, prediction, and counterfactual prediction. And he made the argument that prediction is the task that machine learning is doing well right now, but that the aspiration is to be able to do causal inference through the contrast of counterfactual predictions. Now I'm going to try to pick a slightly adjacent argument, that each of these three analysis use cases can be part of the purview of our informatics community in the space that MLHC could really be focused on. Each of them have value that can deliver for the benefit of patients and clinicians in the healthcare system at large, and each of them are complementary. So when we describe characterization of the IoT community, that very much lines up with Miguel's definition of description. And indeed, when we talk about prediction, we're talking about the same type of prediction that Miguel's talking about. And as I talk about estimation, the idea of causal effects, one could easily project that to counterfactual prediction. What I think we could align on, however, is that we do need to be thinking about this taxonomy as different types of analysis with different statistical methods and a different evaluation frameworks. But what they can all have in common is the opportunity for us to standardize the approach to generate evidence and deliver content that could be directly meaningful to supporting medical decision making. Within the Odyssey community, we've been trying to detail these problems and actually provide even further specification for these types of use cases. Specifically, we've been trying to task ourselves with the challenge of thinking about how can we formalize each of the different use cases that healthcare data could potentially be useful for into a standardized structure. So that if we could frame research questions with a particular format and templatize and standardize the way in which we think about the research question, then we should be able to develop standardized analytics that can answer those questions in a transparent, consistent, and reproducible basis. And so we've created this structure for thinking about characterization, prediction, and estimation problems, whereby we encourage our community to think about research questions by filling in the blanks of any of these questions. For example, if we want to answer a question of disease natural history, we can ask amongst patients who are diagnosed with whatever disease you're interested in, what are the patient's characteristics from their medical history? And by having that fill-in-the-blank template, we can actually really focus on making sure that we're asking the right question for the right disease and apply a consistent analytic framework to each of these questions. Why this is helpful is not only to help the researcher with framing the question, but also to help the development of standardized analytics that can be specifically focused on determining how we want to answer one of these questions given a defined input. And what would the defined output for that question should be? What are the scientific best practices for answering that question? And what's the evidence that we actually want to be able to produce to disseminate an answer when one of these questions is asked? Now, another aspect of standardizing the analysis is that standardization is the only way that I see that we can actually get to the point of scaling evidence generation for healthcare. And I'm going to try to motivate the problem of why this is so important. What I'm showing you here is a matrix of all drugs by all outcomes. If I take the most recent, a single data set and the most recent data I have, I can see that there are over 2,000 active ingredients which are approved by the FDA and used, prescribed to at least one patient in one large U.S. claim database. So let's think about the y-axis of this matrix as being 2,000 dimensions long. If I think about health outcomes of interest, one simple proxy that we can think about is how many distinct diagnosis codes there are. And in 2022, there were over 50,000 such codes used to represent medical conditions that had at least one patient have that information recorded in the same database. And we can think about the question of any of these drugs against any of these conditions as being a potential relationship we might be interested in studying. So hopefully you can see here that we're talking about 2,000 drugs, 50,000 outcomes. That means we have 100 million potential drug-outcome relationships that we want to understand and that patients deserve to know about. And what a patient might want to know about can vary for each of these 100 million drug-outcome relationships. A patient might be interested in characterization. So how often does the outcome happen amongst patients who are exposed to the drug? They may be interested in prediction. So what's my probability of having that outcome after I start treatment, given what you know about my medical history? Or they may be interested in estimation. So does the drug actually cause the outcome? So that's 100 million potential hypotheses that a patient deserves to know the answer to. And here's the unfortunate reality of where we're at. I extracted information from PubMed to look at how many of those relationships can we find an article with published content. It turns out across that matrix of all diseases and all outcomes, indeed less than 0.1% of those drug outcome pairs actually have evidence that is readily accessible through a PubMed search query. And yet, as Johnny Mutis has published in the past, there's also skepticism that most published findings are false. So the bad news is we don't have much evidence. The good news is we're not misleading too many people if that evidence is faulty. I would actually assert that the opportunity that's in front of us and in front of the ML4HC community, and in something that we are focused on in the Odyssey community, is to reshape how we think about generating evidence. To think instead of our current evidence generation process, whereby individual researchers get access to individual data, take an individual hypothesis of some exposure and some outcome, and try to generate one piece of information that they try to go get published, and to throw one dot up on this gigantic matrix. But instead, what they need to be thinking about is a more structural approach to evidence generation, one by which we systematically define all the exposures of interest, systematically phenotype all the outcomes that we want to study, systematically identify the standardized and scientific best practices for generating evidence about characterization, estimation, and prediction, and then systematically apply those methods across a network of data to generate all of the insights necessary for all the hypotheses at once. We're not going to get 100 million answers by having individual researchers go it alone, but I think it is possible that as a community, we can work together to apply machine learning approaches to healthcare data in a way that scales and generates evidence that truly can be trustworthy and actionable. And that's why within the Odyssey community, we are very much focused on our mission, which is to improve health by empowering a community to collaboratively generate evidence that promotes better health decisions and better care. And I'm going to talk a little bit about Odyssey here for two reasons. One, to hopefully introduce you to a community, invite you to participate, but secondly, to provide an example of a model that I hope, whether or not you participate in the Odyssey community, that you'll see opportunities to bring into the research that you all are conducting. Odyssey is fundamentally focused on how do we generate evidence through collaborative efforts. And what we recognize is to generate reliable evidence, we need to have collaborations on multiple different fronts. We collaborate on open community data standards, and indeed our community is the steward of the OMOP Common Data Model, which is commonly used around the world, and the Odyssey standardized vocabulary to represent a standard language for healthcare data. We collaborate on open source development in establishing analytic tools that codify scientific best practices. We collaborate on methodologic research to try to establish those scientific best practices and evaluate them to prove that they're reliable. And we collaborate in evidence generation to be able to take questions that matter to patients and generate the evidence and disseminate it in the public domain. Now, Odyssey also has established the world's largest distributed data network. And what we mean by a data network is any organization who has access to patient-level data has the free and open opportunity to participate in our distributed data network. And what that requires is that any site translates their data from their source form, ETLs it, into the OMOP Common Data Model, and that they also have the capacity within their organization to download and install our open source standardized tools, and that makes it possible that analysis can be run securely within their own firewall. And indeed, in the Odyssey distributed network, each site stands alone securely within their own firewall, repeating this ETL and standardized analytics process. And what that enables is that any researcher in our community can conduct an Odyssey network study, whereby an analysis is pre-specified with a protocol and an analysis specification that's codified into code. That code is made publicly available. Any site in the network can opt in to participate by downloading that code and bringing it securely within their own firewall. And rather than sharing patient-level data, generated by those analysis processes and compiled into results, results repository. And then we collaborate together on interpreting those findings and determining the best course of action for disseminating the results. Now, what I want to encourage and invite all of you to think about is how you could participate in any of these types of collaborations. Within the MLHC community, there's a wide breadth of talent, and some of you can and will make meaningful contributions in the space of data standards. Some of you will contribute to open source development and establishing new analytics practices. Many of you are conducting important methodological research to advance the field and identify new scientific best practices. And I know many of you have specific interests in research questions and clinical areas. Some of you work in institutions who have access to patient-level data and can become part of this network. And many of you have an interest in figuring out how we actually generate evidence and disseminate it in the hands of clinicians and patients to make good decisions. All of these are opportunities for contributions within the MLHC community, and all of you are encouraged and invited to join the Odyssey community if you have interest in any of these areas. Now, within Odyssey, we already have over 3,200 collaborators in 80 countries, and we very much see it as an imperative that we figure out how to collaborate around the world to generate evidence that can be supported for the entire world's population. I mentioned that our first foundation is to standardize the data, and as the stewards of the OMOC Common Data Model, our focus is to figure out how do we establish a consistent structure and a consistent set of content that can be used when we can consider generating standardized analytics. And so the OMOC Common Data Model represents a relational database framework that allows us to represent patient-level data in a consistent structure using standardized vocabularies that let us speak the same language across all of these data sources. And the OMOC Common Data Model has been widely adopted, with over 450 databases having been ETL'd into the OMOC Common Data Model across 40 different countries. And collectively and conservatively, this represents over 920 million unique patient records. Now that's 12% of the world's population. And while that's an exciting and intriguing process to see the progress that's being made through data standardization, I think it also means that we have an imperative to figure out if this much data has been standardized, how do we generate meaningful insights to give back to those patients and the rest of the patients around the world. Standardizing the data also involves standardizing its content, and we do that by creating a shared open community standard, which is the Odyssey Vocabularies. This is our mechanism to standardize content across the different data domains that we have for patients, including drugs, conditions, procedures, measurements, medical devices, and beyond. To date, the Odyssey Vocabulary contains over 10 million concepts, over 80 million relationships, and we can use this medical ontology as a mechanism both to standardize the data as well as to standardize the way in which we ask questions of the data within our analytics. Odyssey's also established a robust set of open source analytics software. This includes back-end statistical packages, very often developed in R, as well as front-end web-based tools. We've seen our tools downloaded from CRAN over 300,000 times over the last year, and that ranges from supporting packages to do large-scale regression and data standardization, all the way through end-user applications for designing and implementing characterization, prediction, and estimation analyses. And we are always looking for new ways to innovate on our tools and inviting new developers to come to contribute to these standardized analytics so that the entire community can benefit from them. As a community, we've been quite productive in publishing our findings as one of our primary mechanisms for disseminating evidence. As a community, we've seen over 590 publications out on PubMed. I'm just going to highlight us four recent examples to try to illustrate the type of work that I see as kind of imperative for how the field needs to move forward. As a community, we publish in the areas of data standards. A recent paper in Journal of Biomedical Informatics specifically focused on the task of how do we take free text clinical notes, apply natural language processing procedures to that, and then standardize the content of that NLP such that we can take that previously unstructured data and create structured content that could then be fed into standardized analytics. We published methodologic research. This recent paper in drug safety specifically was focused on our collaboration with the U.S. Food and Drug Administration and thinking about appropriate methods to be used for supporting vaccine safety surveillance and identifying that alternative methods that are out there that are commonly used in sequential order, potentially we could increase our statistical power and decrease the number of false negative findings we had if we just decide to apply the best practice methods up front. We published also in our open source development within our community, just recently published in Nature Digital Medicine, we highlighted a standardized framework for conducting treatment effect heterogeneity analysis. And what was great about this work is not only did we conduct an evaluation to determine how we could do HDE across the data network, but we also made available an open source tool called risk stratified estimation to add to the toolkit so that we can enable others to be able to conduct this type of analysis in the community. And then of course we published on clinical applications, and in this recent paper in eClinical Medicine, we highlighted looking at the background rates of adverse events within the general population and comparing that to those that were positively infected with COVID-19. What I highlight about this paper is that we had 65 co-authors, 26 databases in 11 countries using over 490 million patient records. And this type of collaboration, I think, is a really good demonstration of what's possible as a community that would be unimaginable to conduct such an analysis if we were to go it alone. Now, I mentioned that we need to figure out a way to conduct large-scale analysis in healthcare. We've been thinking a lot in the honest community about how do we actually engineer some sort of open source system that we believe can build trust in the evidence generation process. And we recognize that part of that process is standardizing data. And indeed, we think one of the value propositions that our community can bring is to work together to establish standardized processes for data, to establish a common set of conventions for which data can be represented, and establish best practices for determining fitness use. But we also need to be able to accompany the standardized data with a standardized analytics framework that we can all trust. And within the Odyssey community, we've been thinking about that in terms of creating an objective diagnostic framework whereby analysis questions can be asked and pre-specified upfront with a full detail of all the necessary elements for conducting analysis, and that we carry through a series of three stage gates before determining whether or not that evidence is indeed trustworthy. Our first stage gate is to do a data quality evaluation. We've established data diagnostics that allow us to determine whether a given source is fit for use for a question. And all too often, someone has a very legitimate research question, has a good idea of what methods one would answer, would apply to answer that question, but the data just isn't sufficient for answering that question. Maybe the key data elements that are needed to define the exposure and the outcome are just outright missing. Or the selection of the population that doesn't represent the targeted patients of interest. So it's important to actually determine whether or not a data source is fit for use before deciding to even move forward to conduct an analysis. And we're thinking about how to do that across the distributed data. Our second stage is phenotype development and evaluation. Once we have a data set identified, we need to be able to determine whether or not we can identify the patients of interest, whether that be the population exposed, the population that's experienced the outcome, or populations to define our indications and subgroups. And as many in the community here know, one of the key challenges is being able to have confidence that identifying the patients of interest is done with appropriate sensitivity, so that we capture all the people we want, specificity so that we're not identifying patients incorrectly, as well as index date misspecification, make sure that we're identifying people at the time that it's appropriate to define their health state. And it's quite possible that in many circumstances, while we have a really good question, we might even have an access to a data set, that it's not possible to phenotype the healthcare phenomenon of interest, in which case we need to be comfortable with the idea that we should stop because we know that anything we do would not be trustworthy. And then our third stage is to develop objective diagnostics to assess the analysis reliability. Now, whether this is for a characterization analysis, a prediction analysis, or an estimation analysis, the idea is that we shouldn't just apply statistics to generate a number, but we should also produce accompanying information that proves that that statistics were faithfully followed, conforming to all of the associated assumptions, and with verification procedures that let us know that the evidence can truly be trusted. In the context of causal inference, we very often think about not just challenging the statistical assumptions that go into causal inference models, but also to be able to apply other diagnostics such as negative controlled outcomes as a mechanism for us to identify whether or not there be residual bias in our analysis and whether or not we can actually calibrate to ensure that our statistics can be interpreted appropriately. Now, what's probably most important about this process is that we have to be comfortable with the idea that really, really good questions, even if they had we had data and we could phenotype the idea that sometimes the statistics aren't going to be appropriate and we need to be comfortable with stopping. So this stage gate procedure basically involves us moving through the journey from data feasibility to phenotype feasibility to analysis feasibility, and only after we can prove that all of those things are trustworthy should we unblind those results and think about the process of disseminating them. Now, the exciting thing about following this process, while it's extremely rigorous, is that this process can be consistently applied. Not only that, we can actually engineer these steps to be applied efficiently in a consistent manner across whatever research question we passed in as a standardized input, and we can standardize the output of the procedure. And that's going to have a tremendous value that I'll highlight in just a minute. Now, given that this is the MLHC community, I want to reinforce something that I know many of you have discussed over the last several years at the conference, certainly the years that I've been there, which is that when we think about applying machine learning algorithms to healthcare data, the problem is a lot more complicated than simply what's the choice of the algorithm itself. We're no longer in a place where we're talking about whether or not we should be using regression or XGBoost or naive Bayes or any flavors of deep learning algorithms, because we recognize the problem of machine learning is the entire journey from data to evidence. And indeed, in our Odyssey community, led by the good work of Jenna Reps and Ross Williams and our patient level prediction working group, we recognize that there's a lot of scientific best practices that need to be established for machine learning that go across that continuum. Questions about how do you establish a standardized framework for applying machine learning to healthcare data? What's the appropriate mechanism for designing patient level prediction models, for extracting data, for doing feature selection? Indeed, there are questions about the appropriate mechanisms for model development, but it goes beyond the selection of an algorithm. We need to also think about how we do transfer learning across data. What's the appropriate processes for test training splits? How do we determine whether or not we have sufficient sample size, and how do we determine if we have too much data? We also need to establish scientific best practices for model evaluation to determine the role of external validation across a network, the usability of a model within a given source or across a source, and also how to actually represent the results of a model and visualize performance to determine that we're using the appropriate metrics to interpret the insights. And it's only after we have all of these pieces in place that should we feel comfortable with actually having clinical applications. And so I'm proud of the work that our Odyssey Patient Level Prediction Work Group is doing, because we're trying to look at this problem holistically, as many of you here at the MLHC community are doing, and recognizing that there's still a lot of work for us to go to establish the appropriate framework before we can trust the evidence and start to try to push that into clinical care. Now, as it relates to causal inference, one of the things that I'm proud that we did in the Odyssey community this year, I want to share as a model. This year, we conducted something that we called the Sisyphus Challenge. The idea was that we wanted the community to raise important clinical questions, and as a community, we wanted to walk through that standardized framework of generating trustworthy evidence as a community by marching through each of the steps systematically, 1 week at a time. We opened the door for questions from the community and identified as a community 4 questions that were particularly interesting. 2 of them specifically were highlighted as community efforts that we were trying to drive forward. 1 was a question from an ophthalmologist raising a concern about the risk of kidney failure associated with anti-VEGF treatments for blinding disease. A second question came from colleagues in our Asia Pacific region asking questions about fluoroquinolones and their risk of developing aortic aneurysms. And while these are very different questions in very different clinical areas brought forth from different geographies, what they had in common was that they were questions that we can apply our characterization, prediction, estimation framework to in a consistent manner and execute analysis consistently across our observational data network. And indeed, we were able to demonstrate that over a couple months, we were able to go from really important questions that didn't have good answers to the largest and most robust studies of these two questions that have been generated, and some of those results are already now in the hands of decision makers who use. I want to also highlight a side benefit of this systems thinking for large-scale analysis in healthcare. Now, I would assert that our current state of observational evidence is the following, that largely we are in a reactive and bespoke process. That is to say, somebody is able to be stimulated with some research question, and on the basis of that, they go get access to some sort of data. They may write down the procedure that they're going to follow to conduct some sort of analysis. They go through some iterative review process, generate an insight, and then decide about whether they're going to publish it. And by and large, this is how the field works as a community. I would argue that standardizing our data enables us to go from that reactive bespoke process to be enabled with the possibility that if standardized analysis exists, then we can have well-defined inputs and fixed outputs that could be generated across the network that could really greatly accelerate this process. But we can and should go further. We could actually have our real-world data be responsive by generating real-world evidence in a much more faster manner. If we had standardized interfaces that allow users to be able to find the inputs and to be able to view the results upon request, that could greatly accelerate this process that we have. We could go even further to be fully prepared, whereby evidence would be generated and available in real time. Imagine having some sort of interface where if you could ask the question you wanted, you could just point and click your way to evidence. And that's possible, but only accessible, only possible if we can standardize our data, standardize our analytics, and standardize the access to that information. But I would assert that where we really all want to be is in a position of being anticipatory. That is, that we can answer questions before they are asked, that we can have the evidence at the disposal at the point of decision-making processes. Now, what is going to enable us to go from our current reality of being a reactive, bespoke process for generating real-world evidence to an anticipatory state of having evidence on demand and influencing decisions directly at the point of care, I would assert is all about standardization. Now, the process that we see, though, is that we can now go from what typically is the case in epidemiology, where a study may take many, many months or even years to generate one insight about one hypothesis in one database, that if we can standardize this process, we can actually scale the time to evidence down to the point that information is available in seconds. And maybe a decade ago, when we didn't have the technology in place, we didn't have the scientific best practices, we didn't have the methods, we didn't have the collective capacity to do this, this may have sounded like a pipe dream, but now we've seen across the Odyssey community and in other efforts that this is computationally feasible and has a lot of value to patients. So I want to ask you all to think about a question for yourself. If you had access to an open community of international, multidisciplinary, cross-stakeholder collaborators, you have an open community data standard that's used by over 400 databases representing 12% of the world's population. You had established and evaluated scientific best practices to ensure that you could generate reliable evidence. And you had a suite of open source tools capable of supporting the journey from data to evidence. What would you do? Because this community exists. You all can and should become a part of it. And what I see is an opportunity. I also sense is a real sense of obligation. Because patients are out there waiting for reliable evidence to all of those 100 million questions that are out there, for every possible exposure that you or a loved one's going to have, for every possible outcome that one might be worried about, we need good characterization, good prediction, good estimation evidence. We need to be able to figure out how to generate that, and I don't think that can be done by us continuing to go it alone to tackle our individual problem with our individual hypotheses in our individual databases. But together, we can develop systematic approaches to generate evidence for characterization, estimation, prediction in a way that can make this information accessible. Within the Odyssey community, we've seen great progress made to generate insights for regulatory authorities about COVID-19. We've generated information about health for hypertension treatments that is now impacting clinical guidelines. And what I see is the big opportunity is for us to think even bigger as a broader community about how real-world data shape healthcare moving forward. So with that, I encourage you to join the journey. Please feel free to reach out to me. Again, I apologize for not being there in person, but I really look forward to having collaborations with all of you and encourage you to reach out to me. Also encourage you to join the Odyssey community and wish you a great rest of the conference. Thank you very much.